laboratory test commissioned by the Campaign for Safe Cosmetics and analyzed by the Environmental Working Group revealed 38 secret chemicals in 17 name brand fragrance products, topped by American Eagle 77, which had 24, Chanel Coco, my daughter Kira, it's her favorite, with 18, and Britney Spears Curious and Giorgio Armani's Acqua di Gio with 17. So those are the ones that you may want to avoid. Let me ask you this, just out of curiosity, how did Ted react to his lead levels? Because that caused brain damage. He must be worried about that.
Well, you know, he's worried about it, but the good news is that he leads a very healthy lifestyle. He exercises a lot. He eats, you know, healthy foods. Where some of his exposure may have come from is living in an older house where, you know, there's lead and in the paint and there's mercury. I mean, he's a fisherman like you are, but he eats what he catches, and he does not read the fishing advisories that the river keepers put out and the different state agencies. So he eats all the freshwater bass he can catch, and that may be where some of his exposure comes from. But even though lead is very difficult to chelate from your body, mercury, you can chelate that over time, and especially if you do certain things to chelate it.
Yeah, I'm actually doing that right now with Dr. Mark Hyman, who
is... I know Mark. He was on our trip with us.
Yeah, he was on the river trip, and he's one of the leading homeopath. He's not... I wouldn't call him a homeopathic physician, because he's like a, you know, he's a mainstream doctor.
Well, he's smart.
Who publishes and...
the connection between chronic illness and environmental exposure. He definitely gets that, and that's... You know, all the billions of dollars that is being raised to figure out how to cure people once they're sick. And you know, that's where all the focus is going, and very little money is going to preventing people from becoming sick in the first place. And our kids, as you know, and I hear you talk so passionately about it, our kids are becoming the canaries in the coal mine. And this is the first generation where our children will have shorter lifespans than the generation before in centuries. So,
well, it's also the same. If you talk to any school nurse in this country who's been at her job for, you know, more than 20 years or 15 years, every person in that position will tell you that this is the sickest generation of children that they've ever seen, you know, in terms of peanut allergies, which were unknown when I was a kid, asthma, which was so rare. My brother was born with asthma, and he was told when he was little that there would never be a cure for asthma because it was so rare that nobody would ever bother to spend the money to study it. And now one out of every four black children have it. One out of every eight kids born in America have it. ADD, ADHD, autism, all of which has gone from 1 in 10,000 to 1 in every 100 children. And all these other illnesses
four kids are obese, and they say, you know, in Atlanta, 18% of our kids are asthmatic. You know, we have a horrible air quality problem here, especially during the summer months, and it's a huge strain on the taxpayers here. You know, and what do they say, too? Cancer rates in children have been up every year for the past 30 years. I mean, we are looking at some really sick children. And what happens as a mother is when you have a sick child, and you know, because Connor, your son, has had severe allergies his whole life and has had to be rushed to the emergency room on numerous occasions, it's very difficult for a mother to get beyond that and be able to contribute to the community and be out there and manage the rest of the family well. I mean, the most painful thing is to be a mother of a sick child or a loved one, whether it's, you know, somebody that's elderly and living with you in your home that could have been exposed to chemicals. I mean, the elderly are also extremely susceptible. from a lifetime of toxins that have built up in their bodies. But, you know, so it's really important that we prevent children from getting sick in the first place. And I think that's why you built your greenhouse, your LEED certified home, which, by the way, I've seen the book and the pictures are phenomenal, and I look forward to seeing it in person. But you have really reduced the amount of chemicals by building this greenhouse. The amount of chemicals that are coming into your house are greatly reduced, and you.
Yeah, and we can see it. And I mean, it's been night and day in terms of the kids, the illnesses. You know, we had a sick house. Our house was making our children sick, and they were sick a lot. They had, you know, we had asthma attacks when they were younger once a week. And now, since we moved into this new house, we haven't had a single asthma attack. But also just they're generally healthier, and you just feel healthier in it. It's, yeah, you live in a greenhouse. You were in one of the first greenhouses built in America, residential LEED certified houses in America, and you must have the same experience.
Well, I know, because we've had our air quality tested by Air Quality Sciences, and they mostly work on OSHA-related exposures in commercial settings, but they've now taken on residential. So we've kind of been a pet project of theirs. And there were some kind of scary findings, because we were, you know, one of the first. We were the first in the Southeast, one of the first in the country. That have made us kind of realize that sometimes when you think you're getting what you want, what you've ordered, it's not necessarily what you're getting, because there's, you know, down the line, the vendors don't know exactly what materials they're using, where they're coming from, and what, you know, chemicals could be in them. So we've had problems with high levels of formaldehyde in this house coming from some of our insulation and some of our cabinetry, which was disturbing. And then also the mercury and the compact fluorescent bulbs. I know it's a tiny little bit, but we had a couple of broken bulbs. We had, you know, detected mercury in the house. And, you know, I am a proponent of, you know, using them, but handling them very carefully. Make sure you get them back to a place that recycles them. And let advocate for the next technology, which is the LED, the light emitting diode technology, which right now isn't, you know, affordable, but it's getting there.
There's a lot of companies out there, but it is within 12 months you're going to see affordable LED bulbs that have paybacks of 2 or 3 years and that produce light that has the same quality, the same warmth, the same red hues that we prefer, that come from the Edison bulbs. The technology on that is moving so fast. There's also new type of lighting, fiber optic cables. I don't know if you have those in your home.
It wasn't really. I know you've used it in your house, but we didn't have access.
Those things are extraordinary. I mean, those things are amazing. So we have almost no compact fluorescence, and I think probably within 5 years, you're going to see a ban on Edison light bulbs, but you're also going to see a ban probably on compact fluorescence as those LEDs become more and more available.